Okay, let me start the second lecture in the course on supersymmetric theories, Seiberg integrable systems, and the quantization of integrable systems. So today I will give you a brief review of Seiberg-Witten theory. So this is all started in a paper by Seiberg and Witten from 94. Okay, first of all, let's recall a bit the discussion that we had on the first lecture on the supersymmetry and the special cases of the supersymmetry which satisfy so-called triality rule on spinors, special for the definition of n equals 1 super Young mills in the dimensions d equals 3, 4, 6, and 10. And as we explained last week, that's related to the division algebras, like real numbers, complex numbers, quaternions, and octonions. Also, I'll recall that at the end of the last lecture was explained that if you start from such n equals 1 super Young mills in this dimension and consider it on a space, d-dimensional space of the form d minus 2-dimensional space times C2, where C2 is a real 2-dimensional space, which we'll take for now to be flat, like R2 or S1 times R1 or T2. Well, if you take the latest case T2 and compactify the theory on XD to XD minus 2 by sending the size of C2 to 0, then we get a certain theory in D minus 2 dimensions with a larger number of supersymmetries. And moreover, if you choose the supersymmetry generator epsilon, such that the supersymmetry transformation generated by that epsilon, where epsilon sits in that odd component of the super Poincaré algebra. Well, I will remind notation. So we had super Poincaré that was a superly algebra, isometry of the space V plus S, where S is a certain spin module, spin V module, which was specially taken or designed in these dimensions to satisfy a certain cyclicity rule with the permutations of three spinors. Okay, so since this is a super Poincaré algebra, we had defined the bracket between two spinors, and that bracket is a symmetric odd-odd bracket, and that's what this notation means. Okay, so delta of epsilon squares to the transformation by the vector field V, which is some gamma mu epsilon. And if you take the supersymmetry such that transformation generated by epsilon would be in the vertical directions, vertical for me directions along C2, then after the reduction on the xd minus 2, delta squares to 0, and it defines cohomological field theory. And the equations for those cohomological field theories, respectively in the dimensions, in the d minus 2 dimensions, 1, 2, 4, and 8, are given by empty equations, flat curvature, f plus equals 0, and spin 7 instantons, that means that projection to the representation 7 in the decomposition of 28 to 1 plus 7 for SO8 under spin 7. Decomposition, I mean, of the antisymmetric forms, two forms. So P7 of F is 0. Okay, so So Seiberg-Witten theory and the continuation of the series of this lecture focuses especially exactly on this case. So this case corresponding to this case. Okay. So this two class of theories we'll be studying. It would be interesting to find what analogous interesting properties could be found for the next one, for the octonionic, but that's for future. Okay, so let me remind a little bit also on this instanton equations, f plus equals zero. So that's called instantons. In 4D. Well, first, it relates to other interesting first of the partial differential equations in the reduced dimensions. Well, plus here means that you take the self-dual part of the curvature under the Hochstar operation. So f plus is zero means that f is minus of the Hochstar of f. Star on a four manifold. Okay, so reduction. So reduction means that you consider the four-dimensional manifold of the form some lower dimensional manifold, and we consider two cases when the lower dimensional manifold has dimension 3. And when the lower dimensional manifold has dimension 2. Okay, and you take these equations and you take all the fields to be independent of the directions in these other two directions, so that the components of the gauge connection, they reduce to the scalars on this space. Now, in in the reduction to three dimensions, if you take the component along the R and denote that component as I4 is phi, the reduction of this equation gives us star f in three dimension is dA phi. And that's a Bogomolnyi equation. For the monopoles. We will encounter more detailed study of this equation in the next lecture. This case leads to the following system. It's convenient actually to twist a little bit the fields here and treat these two scalars, not really the scalars, but as the components of the one form on X2, valued also in the adjoint representation. So A3 and A4, they lead to the field phi, which will be one form on X2. And maybe more properly, that would be discussed if we represent the space X4, actually not as just a trivial product of X2 and R2, but as a cotangent bundle of a two-dimensional Riemann surface. And since this cotangent bundle is naturally equipped by a hyperKahler structure, the reduction of these equations proceeds preserving hyperKahler property. So what we get from the reducing of the two-dimensional case, we get the equations of the form f minus phi which phi is zero, and d phi is 0, and d star phi is 0. One equation from each component of that self-dual two-form. So the set of these equations for the adjoint-valued one-form on Riemann surface X2 and the gauge connection I is called the Hitchin system. Okay, so one important property that I briefly mentioned, but I should stress again, is that these equations, they possess hyperKahler property. So well,
now phi is a complex scalar field.
Here, no, it's a joint valued. Here, phi is valued in the. In this case, phi is just a scalar valued in the Lie algebra G. If you take G to be complex, then it would be complex valued. If G is real, then it's or real valued. Here, phi is one form on X valued in G. If you wish, you can decompose phi. So it has two components, phi mu. And you can decompose that, or like okay, phi x and phi y. You can define phi z equal to be equal to phi x minus I phi y, and phi z bar phi x plus I phi y. And then if you take g to be compact group, so that the Lie algebra of g is real valued, then phi z and phi z bar would be complex valued. Okay, so usually algebraic geometries like to think about the Hitchin system, not in the real language with as a hyperKahler system, but in a complex language as a holomorphic analytic language. And there, okay, so there, the remark that the system, which is given by hyperKahler quotient, could be equivalently represented as a complex quotient of the following system. You consider the space of holomorphic G holomorphic bundles on X2 and a section of K. Phi would be a section of the canonical bundle on X2 valued in the joint representation or valued in the algebra of the gauge group, which is holomorphic, so holomorphic section. This pair, a bundle and holomorphic section, is called the Higgs pair or Higgs bundle on a Riemann surface. Other comments or remarks, questions? So where was I? Ah, yeah, I was going to explain about hyperKahler structure. Well, let me remind that a hyperKahler manifold means that it is first of all a scalar manifold, scalar. So there is a complex structure I, and a symplectic structure omega, and metric G, and they are all compatible. Like G is omega times I. Symplectic means non-degenerate 2 form, which is closed. And complex structure in the real language means just an endomorphism of the tangent bundle of Tm, which squares to minus 1. And that's an almost complex structure. And the integrability of the complex structure means that if you define a sub-bundle of the complexified tangent bundle by the projection to the eigenvalue I of this guy, since it's squared to minus 1 and has eigenvalue I and minus I, so the sub-bundle, let me call it Tm10, which is the sub-bundle of the complexified tangent bundle of M, sections of it satisfy that I times V is IV. Okay, so the differential geometric reminder of what complex structure is. Now, on hyperKahler manifold, those conditions are extended. Okay, let me write it here. So that was for Kahler. By asking existence of three complex structures which satisfy quaternionic relations. So you have I squared k squared cos minus 1, and k is ij, so this is imaginary units of quaternions. And the manifold M is scalar with respect to each of these complex structures. And moreover, you can summarize, you can also induce from that that a complex structure I for any vector x in x2, such that x1 squared plus x2 squared plus x3 squared is 1, given by x1i plus x2j plus x3k. So for a sphere in the space of the imaginary quaternions of norm 1, any such combination is also a complex structure. Okay, so hyperKahler space has a CP1 or S2 worth of complex structures. Okay, that's one reminder about hyperKahler space, which is where, okay, so that CP1 worth of complex structure is used in most of in many physical constructions. But for algebraic geometers, often the hyperKahler space is viewed only in one of its complex structures, and there the hyperKahler property means that, okay, so means that if you consider a two-form omega I given by the combination of the two forms omega j plus I omega k. So this is the real symplectic forms associated to I, j, k, and the metric. And this is a holomorphic form. So this holomorphic form is 2, 0 holomorphic form in complex structure I. So on, in the complex analytic language, hyperKahler property implies that this manifold is a holomorphic symplectic manifold. And omega I is a holomorphic symplectic structure of type 2, 0. Questions? Okay. Now, a good way to construct many of interesting hyperKahler spaces is the hyperKahler quotient. Which is an analog of the usual symplectic quotient. I'm familiar. And that works as follows. So the hyperKahler quotient is defined by taking an action of G group. So group G acts on M. And we ask that this action of G group on M is Hamiltonian with respect to all to the triplet of symplectic structures omega I, omega j, omega k, and let mu I, mu j, mu k be the corresponding moment maps so moment map means that differential of a given moment map, this is one form, and that one form is well, so what are moment maps, first of all? So moment maps are functions on M which are valued in the Lie algebra of G. So this is a and the differential dual valued in the G dual. So the differential of the moment map is the contraction of the vector field corresponding to, well, its value. It's in dual, defined as follows. The value and element of the algebra of G of the differential is the vector field generated by that element of G contracted with the corresponding symplectic form. Okay, so and hyperKahler quotient means that you consider the inverse image of some invariant element under G action. Well, if G is abelian, that if G is U1, that has to be zero. So let's say H and take that space mod the G. So this is the hyperKahler quotient. Okay. And now back to instantons. Okay, so, well, so the main property of the hyperKahler quotient, well, by the name, is that given a hyperKahler manifold with the action of group G on it, this quotient is also hyperKahler. So what are instantons? Well, instantons, as f plus equals zero, the modulo space of instantons, namely the space of connections A on a principal Jimbo bundle on manifold X satisfying this equation mod the action of group G is precisely the hyperKahler quotient as it's written there. The three components of this self-dual equation are the three moment maps with respect to the hyperKahler structure on the space of connections A on a hyperKahler space. Okay, so it's a hyperKahler quotient, so the resulting space, let me call it M, of G of X4, the modulo space of instantons, is again hyperKahler. Okay, now, okay, now let's get back to the super symmetry and discuss the representation of the relevant supersymmetry in four dimensions that we need to further to proceed to Seiberg-Witten theory. Are there questions about that? Okay. Actually, maybe I should ask to interrupt me if that is well known. Should I jump to next, or should I need some feedback from the audience. How on what I'm saying is it well familiar or? People are silent. So now let's focus on this case of n equals 1, super polynomials in d equals 6, and consider reduction to the d equals 4. And let's see how the super Parker algebra of d equals 6, super polynomials decomposes with respect to the d equals 4 symmetries. Well, the n equals 1 Poincaré in d equals 6 was associated to the superspace V6 plus a certain spinor module of spin 6, and that S was taken to be the positive chiral spinors. So this is a 6D Weyl spinors. And the second factor, C2, is an auxiliary factor to have a symmetric map from two spinors in the space. Epsilon gamma epsilon V mu needs to be symmetric. And since the gamma mu just on a Weyl spinors is anti-symmetric, one has to take two copies of those spinors and compose the construction with the anti-symmetric pairing in C2, then the result becomes symmetric. Okay, so and there are the space is eight-dimensional. Now let's consider the reduction to the four dimensions. Okay, so in then V6 is decomposed as V4 plus V2. This would be the two vertical normal components. And the Weyl spinors of the six-dimensional space, they can be viewed just as a Dirac spinors of the four-dimensional space. So S is, let me call that bold S. So the bold S becomes to be the two copies of the Dirac spinors in four dimensions. Again, that's a dimensional space. And okay, so the bracket between the two spinors, which you can compute by reducing from the six dimensions, is going to give a vector in four dimensions plus a vector in the normal two dimensions. If you take two supercharges of that 6D in equals 1 reduced theory and compute their bracket, you find where P mu can be decomposed into four-dimensional plus the normal two-dimensional moment. Now, from the perspective of the four-dimensional, this is just this generator is invariant under all other transformation symmetries. Therefore, therefore the generator is called central charge. Okay, and two more remarks about other symmetries. One symmetry is the following. We can act by the automorphisms of C2, which preserve the symplectic pairing. That's just SP of C2 with respect to this symplectic pairing. In symplectic language, it's SP of 2C. And if you take a compact subgroup of that, it's usually denoted by SP1 or SU2. And in this context, it's called SU2R symmetry. SU2R symmetry. That's one thing. The second thing is, if you consider the decomposition of the spin 6 into spin 4 and spin 2 under this reduction, then spin 2, the rotation of that normal two directions, it would also act on the supercharges, and so spin of the two-dimensional space, just like SO2 or U1, is called U1 R symmetry. Okay, so altogether, let me summarize that what is 4D, what is 6D n equals 1 reduced to 4D n equals 2. We have the following. We have the super-Poincaré algebra of V4 plus P S times C2. So that's 4D super-Poincaré with two copies of Dirac generators of fermionic transformations. And in addition to that, there is an a generator which we call translation in the normal directions or central charge. So let's call this just a complex line. And there is a Lie algebra of the SU2R, SU2R symmetry, SU2R symmetry, and the Lie algebra of the U1R symmetry. So that's the algebra, the super algebra in four dimensions that we need to focus to discuss Seiberg-Witten theory. Questions here? Yes, so this one is six-dimensional. Yes, we decomposed it into projection to four-dimensional and two-dimensional. And this guy, we called it central charge. So the translations in fifth dimension under the reduction to four dimension, they compute with all other generators, and therefore it was called originally in the literature. If you just start from the four-dimensional construction, it's a central extension of the algebra, of this algebra that you can add to it. That's by the name. Okay, now let's discuss our representation of d equals 4, n equals 2. Well, for this purpose, it would be convenient for me to use the hyperKahler notation for the super algebra that I written on in the last lecture as follows. So the space S is identified with the two copies of the quaternions, and V6 acts on that by means of 2x2 matrix. So if I take the generators, the coordinates here as t, x, and y for the space R15 with the signature minus plus. So y is the four dimensional and t and x are coordinates in one dimensional spaces. Then you represent the action on S of a vector from V6 by matrix T plus X, T minus X, Y star, where y is thought as a quaternion. Quaternion from R4 identified with H. So here we have R plus R plus R4 and T, X, and Y respectively are coordinates here, or elements from here. Okay. Okay, now let's consider representation of the n equals to super Poincaré in these notations. So I will discuss one particle representation. Actually, for this discussion, it's not necessarily to be in the four dimensions. Let's stay in six dimensions and discuss the representation of n equals one super Poincaré in six dimensions, and then we consider the reduction.
Sorry, please get t and x are real numbers and y is quaternion.
T and x are real numbers, so that's the stands are identity and y is quaternion. Yes.
But two directions is t and x.
Yes, two directions is t and x.
You're used to kind of indefinite or with indefinite metric.
It's in Minkowski's signature. So t has other signature from everything else.
Because before you make this reduction, two directions will have positive definite metric, for example.
Yes, the two directions which correspond to the other direction, they would sit inside R4.
I see. Ah, so two directions set R4,
Yes.
Okay, so let's discuss one particle representation of that superalgebra. Well, what we have? We have so let's start from 6D and consider a particle which has an energy which has 6D momentum of the form E px 0 and four zeros. So let me denote it by p mu. And in this state in Hilbert space, so it's a subsector of the full Hilbert space of quantum field theory. Let me call it H1. One particle. One particle state with momentum p mu. let's check how the supersymmetry generators act, what their algebra and what representation could be. So in terms of those notations, we have that Q alpha Q beta, which is from H plus H, they give us, delta alpha beta times, let me decompose that in the so let me call components of Q in the first copy of H with index 1 and in the second copy with index 2 So since we have taken this state with E and P just to be along T and X, then we have a diagonal matrix and of the form energy plus Px and energy minus Px, 0 there, 0 here. And then we have that Q alpha, Q beta in the first copy is delta alpha beta epsilon plus Px, and Q alpha, Q beta in the second copy is delta alpha beta epsilon minus Px. Okay. So now, this is exactly commutation relations or anti-commutation relations defining the Clifford algebra. So we have a Clifford algebra on 8 generators, Q alpha 1 and Q alpha 2, and they satisfy these commutation relations. Now, if we want to build a representation of that, we know how to do that. You just take a representation of Clifford algebra. But there is a subtlety related to the fact that while epsilon has to be greater or equal than the moment in the special direction for the state to be time-like. Another way to say it, that the Lorentz invariant combination epsilon squared minus p squared, which is m squared, has to be non-negative. Yes. So in the boundary case when epsilon equals p, namely when the particle is light-like, here is zero, and so the anti-commutation relations for q alpha q beta in the second copy, they have to be trivially satisfied. Okay, so let's consider those two cases separately. So the first case, when epsilon minus px is greater than zero, then you have the Clifford algebra on eight generators. And we built its representation. So it should be 2 to the d minus 2. So it's 2 to the 4. That's a 16-dimensional representation, yes, of Clifford 8. And if you build that representation by starting from like a Fock vector, well, from some element in the Hilbert space and applying to it the raising operators, which you construct from this q alpha and q beta, well, let me define raising operators. Just break that spin A to u4 and consider combinations q alpha plus minus q alpha plus 1, for alpha 1, 3, 5, 7. Yeah, so that would be a raising-lowering operator. They square to 0, and they anti-commute to 1. And applying raising operators, the states in the Hilbert space can be depicted as follows. That's the vacuum state, then you act by 4 raising operators that you have here. Then you act again, you get 6 states, then 4 more. And then finally 1. So another way to say what I'm doing here, it's just exterior algebra in the C4. Yes, so corresponding to the action of 4 raising generators. And the diamond with 1 state here, 4 states here, 6 states here, 4 states here, 1 state here, is what is called long multiplet. Okay, if the original state is bosonic, then the statistics of the states change with the level. So the bosonic state, fermionic, bosonic, fermionic, bosonic. For us, a particular important would be degenerate representations called short multiplets. And they are associated to the case when p is equal to epsilon. So it's light-like. So if e is px, like state, so the mass, the 6D mass is zero, and then okay, so then the discussion is similar, except that q alpha and q beta in the second copy, they have to be zero because they square to zero, and in the unitary theory, these are Hermitian operators, so they have to be zero. Now, in the first copy, we again have Clifford algebra on four generators. Yes, and that gives us 2 to the 2. That's four-dimensional space, and that four-dimensional space decomposes as 2 plus 2 with 2 bosonic states and 2 fermionic states. And if you draw the diamond associated to the action of raising operators, it goes like that. So for example, you can start from the spin 1/2 and act by the spin decreasing operators q. You would have two states at the spin 0 and one state at the spin minus 1/2. So this this particular example is called half hypermultiplet. Okay, so it has one Majorana fermion with helicity plus 1/2 and minus 1/2, and two scalars, two real scalars. Okay, another thing we can do with this short with short multiplet is to tensor it with a representation of spin 4. And if you consider particular case when you tensor this diamond with a spin 1/2 state, so that is plus 1/2 minus 1/2, you get a diamond of the form like that. You need to shift this one upstairs by 1/2 and add to a copy of it which is shifted downstairs by 1/2. Okay, so that is that state is of helicity 1, that's helicity 1/2, that's helicity 0, that's helicity minus 1/2, and that's helicity minus 1. And now if you think in terms of massless fields, then these states 1 and minus 1, they correspond to the vector. Masses vector is helicity plus minus 1. Yes, this state this is a scalar. So since we have two of those, we have a complex scalar. Okay, and these states with the two Majorana fermions. Yes. So since there are two of those, it's okay. Two copies. I will just write two copies. And that's actually the natural fermions. If you take them to be just induced by the representation as this one that we are considering. So there are sections of S. I've mentioned here half hypermultiplet. Why half? Well, the reason is that to have a true representation of the n equals 2 supersymmetric algebra, we need the space of scalars to be to have hyperKahler structure. In particular, it's supposed to be four-dimensional. So here we have only two real scalars. So to get a four-dimensional space, the standard construction is the following. If there is a gauge group whose representation rho is a complex, so suppose R is complex rep of G, then hypermultiplet is a half hyper, which is written there, taking the representation R plus another half multiplet, taking the representation a bar. And all together, that gives a hyperKahler structure on the space of scalars of the hypermultiplet. Another way to do hyperKahler structure is just to consider representation quaternionic. This quaternionic structure in itself so another way is take R tilde, which is quaternionic G module, and then take just a half hypermultiplet tensor this representation. It also gives a full hypermultiplet. Okay, so that's about the names. And okay, and now let's get back to the fields. I should have said that. Yes, in this discussion, so far we just presented the story in the six-dimensional notations. Now let's see what happens when we reduce to the four dimensions. Well, when we reduce to the four dimensions, let me now take another convention and think about the coordinate x as one of the coordinates which goes in the normal direction. And also, let me make a U1 R symmetry transformation in such a way that the momentum along that direction is real. So then Px should be just thought as a central charge in terms of the four-dimensional language. So it's related to this discussion. So if in 4D picture, Px is treated as central charge, so that x is along reduced dimensions. Then the two cases that we had here are the following. The first case is when the energy in the rest mass.
Yes, I think I lost. Yes. But before it was in six dimensions, isn't it multiplied by spin 1/2? Before this been spin 1/2? So you mean it's multiplied. This really makes sense. If you're in six dimensions. Representation of five dimensional rotation.
No, four dimensional, because this is because this was discussion of the short multiplet when epsilon is px, so it's a master state, and for master state you take spin four, you get two dimension less, so you have spin four, and that's 1/2 of spin four, the helicity of spin four. Okay, now discussing back on the four-dimensional picture. So let's take the case when the particle is at rest, assuming that it's a massive particle and it is at rest, and interpret px that we had in those formulas as a momentum along the fifth direction, so it's a central charge. And then the two cases that we have considered there, the case one is when E minus the value of the central charge usually is denoted by Z in literature. When the first case was when it's bigger than zero, and then we had long multiplet, yes, discussed over there. And the second case is when epsilon, the energy E, is exactly equal to the absolute value of the central charge. It means that the particle in six dimension is light-like, but when you reduce it to four dimension, all its momentum is in the fifth and sixth direction. It has zero momentum in three-dimensional space, and it has momentum E in time direction. Okay, so this situation from discussed representation of the supersymmetry algebra, we have seen that it reduces to the short multiplet. Yes. So the states in the Hilbert space which satisfy this condition, they are also called BPS states. Okay. Now the fields. So we've discussed massless vector, and the fields that describe massless vector multiplet are the following. It's just dimensional reduction of n equals 1 vector multiplet from six dimensions. So you have a gauge connection, a mu, complex scalar phi, and the fermion psi, which is a section it's a section in gamma of X4. The spinner bundle S constructed from the two copies of Majorana spinners or holomorphic Dirac in Euclidean signature. So to define the vector multiplet, we just need to take the data that we need to choose is semi-simple group G, semi-simple compact group G, and let me introduce the notation, the reduction of G into simple factors would be product over the set capital I, and simple factors would be called G sub I. There's a simple compact. The Lagrangian is the Yang-Mills Lagrangian, was properly extended with the couplings with the fermions. The essential part in this Lagrangian is for each simple factor, we have 1 over g squared of which f plus I tau I theta over 8 pi squared f which f. So that's that gives Yang-Mills kinetic energy, and that gives the topological coupling called also theta term in physical literature. Mathematically, it corresponds to the second Chern class of a given field configuration. Okay, so that's for each I haven't written here, but it means that for each I we have two real numbers, 1 over g squared and theta over 8 pi squared, and the combination written like that, this I is square root of minus 1, maybe I should not too confused. So this is called the complexified coupling constant. Okay, so that's it for the definition of the vector multiplet. Just to summarize, the data is the same simple compact V group and the array of complex constants. Okay, that's it for the vector. Yes, it depends on the global structure of the group. So
the group is not really product of simple factors on the universal cover. Because
it's universal cover divided by some
subgroup in the center.
I mean, but for physics, I mean, it's the global structure of G is important. Like, if instead of SU2 you would assume that it's SO3, then there would be no quarks.
Yes, yes, yeah. No, I just want to say that the group is not necessarily product of simple groups.
Ah.
Under universal cover.
Okay. Yes. Yes, okay. So I agree. But let me stick here to this assumption. So hypermultiplet. So the fields there corresponding to the two copies of this guy that we had here is two Majorana spinors, yes, and two complex scalars that are combined together into one quaternionic. So hypermultiplet is a generalization of quarks or electrons which couple to the gauge connection, and so we have to choose the representation of the gauge group in which they enter the theory. And the additional data to describe n equals 2 theory is the set of masses for those multiplets, and it's convenient to think about those masses in the following way. We actually take pick another group let me call it F, and it's called flavor symmetry. So this one I just want to be compact. It might contain U1 factors. Well, I said they're semi-simple. I don't want to consider U1 abelian factors, since famous Hooft result on the value of the beta function for the coupling constant. And U1 abelian theories, the beta functions for them, they behave bad when you go to the small distances, and it's not good to define the theory as a sensible quantum field theory. So there are only non-abelian factors there, but for the other flavor symmetry group, it doesn't have a gauge field over which you integrate. It just couples with a fixed coupling to the fields of the n equals to supersymmetry of a vector multiplet. To the hypermultiplet. So it might have U1 factors. And then peak representation or representation of F times G, and ask this representation actually to be quaternionic. So the hypermultiplet is sits in the representation of F times G. It couples like it's supposed to couple to n equals to vector multiplet. And also it couples to the constant scalars of the n equals 1 vector multiplet for the flavor symmetry from which we keep on the complex scalars. And the values of those complex scalars up to the conjugation by F are called masses of the n equals 2 theory. So the other data that we have here, the masses, that would be an element of the complexified group of the maximal torus of the flavor symmetry. Like M1 the dot MF for this torus is U1 to the F, for example.
Here, you don't, can deduce on 6 dimensions here, some situation, dot in 4 dimensions, right. Yes, yeah.
Yes, so where the masses come, I mean, start, yeah. Can you write in details from 6, the 6 dimensional Lagrangian?
No. I
don't think it's No. It's what Maxim mentioned. So it's in four-dimensional. It's four-dimensional setup constructed by the following way. You consider n equals 1. You consider vector multiplet associated to the flavor symmetry. Yes. And this vector multiplet, when it reduces to four dimensions, it has a complex scalar coming from the two components that we have reduced. And that complex scalar is fixed to a particular value.
You do not have Fourier meals. Sorry, I thought you were starting from Fourier meals.
In 6D you have pure Young meals, and also in 6D you.
What are all the fields in 4D coming from?
In 6D you have a massless n equals 1 vector multiplet, and in 6D you have. Yes. No. It's Young meals with that spin or psi. So.
Yeah, it's super Young
meals. It's super Young meals. Yes. In 6D, with two spinors, with two Majorana Weyl spinors in 6D.
The scalars, they are finally two complex scalars.
In 6 dimensions you don't have those scalars. The scalars are coming by reduction of 6 dimensions to 4D. Yes. Yes.
Then
you consider in the 6D theory a vector multiplet for the flavor group F.
That you add to the theory?
Yeah, that you add to the theory, okay. Yes. It has the gauge fields, the gauge field, the 6-dimensional gauge field, and also spinner. Then you reduce it to 4 dimensions, okay? And you give a background value to the complex scalars of the flavor symmetry group. And you set all the rest of the fields of the vector multiplet for the flavor group F to zero. And that gives a way to write a Lagrangian in a compact form.
And how many hypermultiplets? 1, 0? No, I'm confused.
No, in 6D it's a hypermultiplet. Well, it depends on how you count. It's in a representation of F of F times G. The dimension can be as large as you want, or up to the constraint on beta function that we are going to discuss now. Shall we do a short break? What do you think? Okay, then maybe a 5-minute break. So there was a question about Lagrangians. So let me write the standard quadratic Lagrangian. For n equals to vector in 4D. Actually, by reducing the Lagrangian of n equals 1 vector multiplet in 6D. So the Lagrangian of vector multiplet in 6D is very simple. It's just it's Lagrangian for the fields a psi, where psi sits in S. Again, two copies of Majorana-Weyl fermions in 6D. And it's just supersymmetric Yangian. So it's Fmn, Fmn. G6, 1 over G squared, yes, plus psi Dirac operator psi I runs from 1 to 2. That's for the two copies. And the contraction is with the antisymmetric epsilon ij, yes. So psi I is Majorana-Weyl fermion in the 60.
So what is the origin of the theta?
The origin of you don't have that in 6D. You add it by hand. You notice that it's possible to add it after you consider the theory reduced to the four dimensions. Since it's topological term, it depends just on the topology of the smooth principal G bond on the four-dimensional manifold. It doesn't affect invariance of the action of the supersymmetry transformation. Okay, so under reduction to the 4D, okay, what happens? So fmn, fmn splits into the f mu squared. Okay, let me take convention that m is from 1 to 6, and mu is from 1 to 4, and ab from 5 to 6, yes? So then it would be f mu squared plus d mu phi a, d mu phi a, this kinetic term for the two real scalars, yes, plus phi a phi b squared. That's a commutator for the two scalars. And okay, that's it for the bosonic fields. And for the fermionic fields, you have the gauge. Well, the four-dimensional. The 4D Dirac operator on psi, and from the reduction of the fifth and sixth components here, you would have like Yukawa coupling, usually called in physics. That's psi I, and then okay, so that would be phi 6 plus I phi 5. Times gamma 5 psi I. Okay, that's the 4D Lagrangian for for the vector multiply to which you can add topological term, as was mentioned there. So for hyper multiples, well, I will not write it, but it's just a complex scalar field and two fermions, which are coupled to the gauge fields of this vector multiplet in the suitably supersymmetric way.
There are potential terms.
Yes. No, I mean they constrained by the n equals 2 supersymmetry.
Yes, to be still it's a prepotential. I mean there are arbitrary functions, no? Or you take a quadratic potential.
Oh, here it was quadratic. Yes. Now we are going to discuss, yes. Yes. Precisely, we'll discuss the nonlinear Lagrangians shortly. I just want to summarize first what are constraints on this data by which you can define the sensible quantum field theory in the UV without the need of other fields called ultraviolet completion. So what are the conditions? The conditions are UV complete theory. Defined by the data G tau. Yes, R, which is G of quaternionic representation, and masses in the complexified torus of the flavor symmetry group. So what are constraints on here? Well, the notations, which one? This one?
No, the masses are in one.
Ah, the notation, it's the Lie algebra. It's what was written here.
Okay.
Yes, it's the Lie algebra of the maximal torus of the F. Cartan, it's Cartan of F. Yes, Cartan of F. Cartan-Lie algebra. Okay, that's what completely defines the theory. So, what are constraints? The constraints are well known since the calculation of the beta function, and the constraints are this: in each factor, I of the group G. So G is a product of simple factors Gi, the beta function should be non-positive. Otherwise, the theory is strongly coupled on small distances, and it cannot be essentially defined as an ordinary quantum field theory. It needs other degrees of freedom. So the
and in the infrared, then can you have problems?
Yes, in the infrared. I mean, in the infrared, you have strongly coupled physics, and that's exactly what we want to understand. Yes. But the quantum theory is defined in UV, and then it gives some interesting interaction theory in the infrared.
It's asymptotically free.
In the UV, it's asymptotically free. Yes. Free. In UV. Okay, so the beta function works as follows. So if you compute it, then you find that, so 1 over g squared Yang-Mills on the ith factor with scale mu. Okay, so let me just tell a few words on the renormalization here. So let's consider the space of fields. Let me draw like that. So up to here would be fields with with momentum mu, and here would be fields with a momentum lambda. So this is this is the energy scale. So usually when we talk about quantum field theories, we integrate over all fields above a certain scale and compute the effective action at the given scale mu. So if you fix the coupling constant at the scale lambda and then integrate over all fields to get the effective action at the scale mu, then the effective coupling constant at the scale mu is related to the effective coupling constant at the scale lambda, well, the one loop level by the beta function related, by the beta function relation. And that's 1 over g squared to scale mu is 1 over g squared to scale lambda plus this combination, plus 1 over 8 pi squared logarithm mu over lambda, well, times a certain factor. And this factor for n equals 2 theory
you do calculation
not the in 4 dimensions. In 4 dimensions.
Is it a little bit not reasonable for us to study generalization group in 6 dimensions? It makes sense.
Well, unfortunately, it doesn't. So yes,
doesn't make sense,
right. Six dimensional theory is not renormalized.
It's not renormalized. And it's not a problem. Yes, so in fact, that it's not renormalized.
So we are doing 4D theory.
So 6D to explain supersymmetry. Yes, it's kind of formal algebraic tool.
Well, not only we could start in 4D, but 4D is a nice way to see the classical theory, and later we'll consider six-dimensional theory, but we'll take it in the context of string theory. So 6D theory, it requires UV completion by string theoretic degrees. So here in 4D, and you can think about the fields of the 4D theory as usual quantum fields without string theory. Mm-hmm. So that's the old computation of by Hoft and others. So the beta function, where this factor, if you compute it in the n equals 2 theory, so with the gauge group G and representation R, yes, with some simple. Take it simple group G and a quaternionic representation R of this group, this factor turns out to be equal to C2 of the adjoint of G minus C2 of the representation R. And by C2, I mean the coefficient in the metric defined by the taken trace in the representation R. It's to be defined to be as C2 proportional to the standard metric on the Lie algebra. So H is in the Lie algebra of G, and this metric is normalized such that the highest root H cosine square equals to 2, the standard normalization. So then the factor in front of the standard metric, if you compute the metric by taking the trace in the representation, is called C2, and that's what contributes to the one loop beta function. Okay, so for example, for g equals SUN, you have C2 of adjoint. Well, actually, that's more general formula. It's always twice the dual Coxeter number. So for SUN, it's 2n. And C2 of the fundamental is 1. Okay? So the constraint on the beta function, we want this term to be positive, so that 1 over g squared goes to 0 if you send mu to infinity. It gives the condition that number of the fundamental multiplets, which was called the flavor group, is U of number of fundamental multiplets. Yes. And from here we see that the number of fundamental multiplets, let me call it an F, should be less or equal than to n. So that's a constraint on the representation R when the gauge group is just a simple un and you consider representation, several copies of the fundamental representation. So how about a general case? Well, actually, it becomes quite elaborate but solvable. It's a certain combinatorial problem on the space of Dynkin diagrams and representations, and it was completely solved recently in a paper by Tajikawa and Hardwai. So that they have complete classification of pairs G and representation R, such that that beta I is less than 0 in each I.
Could you sort of make slightly more explicit what this means, that you're trying to explain some constraints on the data at the top and you've written down this expression, but how does it relate to the data? I mean, the G is related to the imaginary part of Tor, but what else is happening there?
Yes, it's a constraint on the combinatorial data. It's just a constraint on the choice of representation R that we can do.
But I've not understood what this 1 over g squared yn times m or as a function of m equals, and what's the lambda
beta,
there?
It's some kind of beta function story about Hall-Coupling.
So how does that depend on the data that we picked at the start?
Oh, yes. How it depends? It depends in terms of this coefficient. The coefficient which stands here is the difference between the C2 of adjoint representation of G and C2 of representation R.
Sure, but I've not understood how M and lambda depend on the...
It doesn't depend... Okay, so this is one loop beta function computed in the UV regime, which is more... with energies more greater than all masses in the theory. So it doesn't depend on masses. It depends only on the space of fields.
Complicated function of G, Tor, and R, and G plus F. How do I sort of work out what that function is?
No. A beta function is a vector field on interest in one variable, and you need to be contracting. And one variable is coupling constant.
So, unless I've misunderstood, you're trying to explain a sort of constraint on the data the data is g, tau, and r and stuff.
Yes.
Yes, the data here as g, tau, and r, and the constraint implies actually just the constraint on g and r, on how big r could be chosen for a given g.
If there's no rules here, yeah.
So I've not done.
Yes, masses and taus. Well, there's actually the running of taus, but masses play no role here. Yes.
Okay, but what does this equation with the m and the lambda have to do with the choice of g and tau?
No. It's an explanation about beta function.
Yes, it's a computation which I didn't do. But okay, let me give you a cartoon. Okay,
it's more the derivation of what the constraint is, and then the constraint is just that this star has to be something or other.
Yes.
Okay, so that's much simpler. Okay.
Yes. I confused here. So this constraint that beta function is negative, it means that this coefficient must be positive. Yes. That's the requirement. The requirement is that this constraint is positive. Okay. Maybe zero. Yes. The zero case, when it saturates, is called the theory in conformal class. So in particular, this one, when an f equals to n, it's...
The beta I depends on the ith factor of g.
On ith, yes, it's for each ith factor. So here you take a adjoint of gi, yes, and you consider representation r as the representation of gi subgroup of g. Mm-hmm. Okay, so they have complete classification of this combinatorial data, just pairs G and R, and it's quite elaborate. I don't have time to explain all this classification. Let me give you just a subset of it, which you can trace yourself easily. So the subset of this classification is the following. Let's assume that G is a product of SU and I factors, yes, and let's assume that the representation R is just a sum of some bifundamental representations between different nodes here. Yes, and plus possibly fundamental representations from an I to some fixed vector spaces, which are called NFI, attached to each node. Yeah, so that could be graphically pictured by a quiver. So where circles denote gauge groups. And arrow between circles denote by fundamental representation. And to each circle, you can attach a square, and the arrow between a circle and the square denotes a fundamental representation. So that's fundamental here, and this bifundamental over there. Yes, you can also have dual. It doesn't affect the computation of the beta function. Yes. Yes, you can have a dual. Okay, so for this quiver, let's see. So we've just computed that representation of C2 of adjoint is 2 and C2 of each fundamental is 1. So if you have a node to which an I to which you have attached NF fundamental representations and some neighbor nodes which have NJ, sitting in those. Then if you compute the contribution of all these hypermultiplets into the beta function of an I, you find that that coefficient, which was like minus beta function, yes? So this coefficient turns out to be 2ni minus nf. That's what we already did just for a single gauge group. And then all these neighbors, they contribute a factor of an I. Of nj, so minus sum over nj where J and I are linked. I mean, for each link. And you can try attach like two by fundamental representation. In principle, it's also possible. So for each link here contributes. Okay, and then that's a certain just discrete problem on the space of graphs, and it turns out to be equivalent exactly to the Cartan, Dinkin, maybe Katz classification of generalized Coxeter, of generalized Cartan matrices. Of generalized Cartan matrices. And the result is that for the class of the theories, the possible diagrams that you can draw have to be so that quiver, let me call it gamma, is AD. Or a fine AD Dinkin graph. In particular, that's what I was trying to picture here. This is allowed that correspond to A1 hat. Is okay. And one more remark. So it's an example of affine graph, and actually AD affine graph always leads to the beta function equals zero. So all such theories are in conformal class. All such, I mean affine. Affine theories are in conformal class.
What happened for the different gauge group, like SLO or SP?
Yes, you can find classification in the paper, but roughly you can have a large class of graphs where you alternate SO and SP between nodes, and then there is a certain number of exceptional configurations. Well, it's a certain combinatorial problem extending this Cartan classification, and it's completely written down.
Can you go to a situation in which you have more like a fixed point sort of hierarchy theory, which flux one to the other.
You mean on the renormalization group?
When yeah, but they start from a.
No, not for n equals two theories, no.
So is NF arbitrary or is it zero here? For these graphs, these affine AD or.
AD? Oh, so for affine, yes, for affine, NF is zero. It's in conformal class and NF must be zero. I mean, it is implied by you see by the fact that on the Cartan matrix of affine graph, the sum. I didn't finish. Okay. So one more data. NF is zero and NI is a chosen positive integer times AI hat, where AI hat is a Dinkin number attached to each node. And then automatically you have the beta function is the zero vector of the generalized Cartan matrix, the null vector which is annihilated by the Cartan matrix. Yes, so for finite Cartan graphs, it's possible to have some positive NF attached, and it depends on what numbers and I you assign to it. But you just need to satisfy this equation.
So. So, for instance, for the
E9
case, what does it mean?
Yes, so I mean E9 quiver. Yes, so it's not E9 gauge group, it's a 9 quiver, which means E8 hat, which is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, yes, 7, 8, 9. And you put numbers here, you put, okay, so AIs that you put here is UN. Well, let me write I's. So it would be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, what was there? 2, 4, 3 maybe? 3, yes? 12, 7, yes. Yes, so if you compute 2n here in this node, it's 12. If you compute the sum of neighbors, it's 5 and 3 and 4, and it's 12, yes? 5, 3, and 4 is 12. And all other nodes, it's obviously that also it holds because it's arithmetic progression here, so each node is arithmetic, mm-hmm. is the mean of the two neighbors, yes? Mm-hmm. So if you take the gauge group, which is a product of U, and AI check, and that's an example. Mm-hmm. Okay, now let's discuss the low energy theory. So first of all, what do I mean by low energy theory? I mean the following. If you start from that theory in the UV, remember that for the scalar fields we had potential. Five six, commutator squared, and that potential classically vanishes when 5 5 and 5 6 commute. So by conjugation, by the gauge group, we can bring them to Cartan, to the two elements in the Cartan of the gauge group, and so the modular space of vacua of the classical vacua. Is just the complexified Cartan of the gauge group of G. Yes, mod the wild, because we can bring the two elements to Cartan mod the wild group of transformation. So, for example, if G is SU2, then this classical modular space of vacua, let me call it M, just complexified Cartan of SU2, it's a complex line C, mod Z2, where Z2 acts by reflection. It sends A to minus A. Now, what are excitations around classical vacuum? So that's what low energy theory is. So the gauge group of the low energy theory, G of infrared, when you consider phi to be sufficiently large, and the gauge group completely broken by phi, I mean phi generic element of the Cartan, then the gauge group is a maximal torus of G. Yes, so it's just U1 to the rank of G. And that's abelian theory. Yes. Thank you. Yes. So I should remark here that this discussion is for the case when the hypermultiplets do not have wave, and that's classical. The module space of classical vacuum here consider only one branch of it. It's called the Coulomb branch. There is another branch that Thibault just mentioned. It's called Higgs branch, and we are not considering it in this story. So the analysis of n equals to a billion vector multiplet leads you want to the R leads to the following geometry of the sigma model. So this is a nonlinear nonlinear model with n equals to symmetry of the maps from the space-time R31 to the module space of vacuum. And that module space of vacuum, by the requirements of n equals to supersymmetry, it needs to be special Kahler manifold. So what it means that it's special Kahler? It means that there is a set of special coordinates. One can give the coordinate independent definition, but let me introduce some coordinates to write a Lagrangian. There is a set of special coordinates. Let me call them AI, which are holomorphic coordinates in a complex structure defined by the Kahler structure of this module space. And the Kahler metric, JG, is imaginary of the second derivative of a certain holomorphic function of A over dAi dAj. So the Kahler potential has a certain special form, Kahler potential of A bar is real of Aj bar dF over dAi. Another way to say the definition, whenever you can choose a Kahler potential, whenever you can find the coordinates A and the holomorphic function f of A such that the Kahler potential has the form, you have a special Kahler structure, at least locally. So in terms of this Kahler potential and the prepotential f, you can write down the Lagrangian of n equals to abelian theory. Excuse me?
You contract the index I the same?
Did I? Yes.
The same index.
Yes. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Okay, let me write the Lagrangian in terms of n equals 1 superfields. I haven't explained it, but okay, that's for people familiar with n equals 1 supersymmetry, and then I will just reduce it to components explicitly. But Okay, so that's the kinetic term for the gauge fields. So what are the gauge fields here? Wi sub alpha, where alpha labels the basis in S plus and the chiral spinners of the 4D. Okay, and I from 1 to R just labels this U1 abelian multiplets. So for each U1 abelian multiplet, you have a photon, and the corresponding supersymmetrization of that photon is denoted by Wi alpha. Phi is a complex field . The bosonic part of it corresponds to the complex coordinates AI. On the target space, F sub IJ is the second derivative of the prepotential function. And also it's called tau. That's a matrix of the coupling constants that you obtain from this term for the photons, for the f mu squared.
And alpha is equal to beta? It's
beta, which beta?
There are two indices on W
here. Oh, yes, thank you. Mm-hmm. Yes, thank you. Okay, so this is the kinetic energy for the gauge fields. So the 1 over g squared, the coupling constant, it might have a nonlinear dependence on a point on the modular space of vacuum where we study the theory. So that's why we call this theory nonlinear sigma model. It might depend on phi by some non-constant function. The standard quadratic Lagrangian that we had written previously corresponds to the quadratic f. When f is phi squared, then the second derivative is constant, and that gives just the standard Lagrangian. Okay, so that's kinetic term for the gauge fields, plus there is a kinetic term for the scalars, and the kinetic term for the scalars in n equals 1 notations, so called by physicists D term. It corresponds to the Keller potential, yes, which we have chosen, which is given by this expression. And so the Keller potential, in which we plug in superfields, chiral superfields, phi bar EV F I of phi. So this is the Lagrangian, of n equals 2 abelian theory in n equals 1 superfield notations. So the important... I'm finishing in 2 minutes. Yes, V is the superfield, which is the gauge field, the gauge extension, supersymmetric gauge extension. So W alpha is d bar squared d alpha of V. So n equals 1 real multiplet, and this is mean, okay. Okay, let me just finish with the important part of this Lagrangian. So the important part of this Lagrangian is the coupling to the gauge fields, and it goes as follows. So if you integrate and expand the components, you find the Lagrangian in the form F minus I, sorry, fi minus, fj minus, minus denote anti-self dual part, and ing denotes components of the curvature along the ith abelian factor, tau ij. What was that dot? Plus tau ij bar fi plus fg plus. So this tau ij is a matrix R times R, matrix of complex constants. And it's a generalization to the rank R generalization. Of the formula tau equals 4 pi I over g squared Yang-Mills plus theta over 2 pi. It's symmetric. It's symmetric. And also for this Lagrangian to be positive definite on the fields Fi, the imaginary part of tau ij is positive definite. Okay, so that what defines the Lagrangian in the infrared for the abelian U1 vector multiplets. And we'll continue with that next time. There are questions.
Why there's no correspond in the I coupling and the
there's only the minus plus. I mean you can there are just two independent terms. Yes, it's f wedge star f and f wedge f, and you can redecompose that in terms of f minus and f plus there are just two parameters, and these two parameters is tau ij and tau ij bar. And for normal sensible theories, tau ij bar is the complex conjugate of tau ij. In the complexified theory, one can do tricks and treat those parameters as independent, not necessarily complex conjugate. But there are just two corresponding to the basis of these expressions.
This is effective theory around the vacuum solution.
Exactly. This is effective theory around a vacuum, yes, parameterized by the scalar field phi. So tau ij, they are functions on the space of vacuum in which we have coordinates phi I, and they are functions of phi, and they are given by the second derivative of the prepotential functional f.
Kinetic terms of the phi's?
So these are kinetic. What are the kinetic terms of the phi's? Sure, the kinetic terms of the phi's. Well, roughly, yes, roughly is just d phi is d mu phi I d mu phi j bar, and you couple I and j bar using the Kähler metric on the target space. So you have here imaginary part of tau ij. So it's nonlinear sigma model into the Kähler space, which has in addition the special Kähler property that the Kähler prepotential is of that form. And then that's n equals 2 abelian Lagrangian, nonlinear Lagrangian.
And Fa, so it's the logarithm of the contribution of each vacuum. Of the sum of the contribution for each vacuum.
Sorry, what is logarithm?
Fa.
FA
function is like
FA, yes. FA FA is a certain complicated function, and one goal would be to find that function. Yes, it's contributed. You can compute it perturbatively. It has contribution in one loop, then it stops, then it has no contributions in higher orders of perturbation theory, and then it receives contributions from instantons.
So he has also one loop contribution.
Yes. FA has a one loop contribution, yes. F of A roughly goes F of A, if you compute it, roughly it would be A squared log A plus contribution, so that the tau would goes as log A plus instanton contributions. Instanton contributions are power series, so that's power series in 1 over A squared or A to the, yes. Well, that depends on a theory, but generally, but power series in the inverse of A.
I got slightly mixed up about the relation between this and the story we had before. Is it the same that the low energy version of that becomes the sigma model into the vacua that we had before?
Exactly. So we've discussed before that classical module space of vacua, it was just a complexified Cartan mod while group. In quantum theory, it receives a certain non-linear, non-trivial metric. One goal is to compute that metric. After the metric is computed, the low energy effective theory is nonlinear sigma model, which is n equals to sigma model of the maps of the space time to that special Kalerman.
Here is the space that was the classical vacuum in the board before.
Yes, it's as a complex as algebraic manifold is just the same space. It's just an affine space, in fact. But it has a certain non-trivial metric on it, yes. Okay. Thank you.